so many things. There's never enough time to talk. You know what I'm saying? His young sister, his young brother up here had something to talk about, and we didn't have enough time for it, you know? Because this moment that we have here, this moment recognizing Dr. King's legacy, his untimely death 50 years ago tomorrow, a moment where we find to gather our senses, to gather ourselves, to find ways in which we carry on that, him being that symbol in that moment of what was just and what was to do, what we had to do, the work set out to do. We remember that he was organizing sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee. Men who stood up and said, I am a man. We realized that he was doing that at that critical moment in the organizing of the strike itself and the participation and the heroism of those men who stood up as well. We also realized that he was down in Alabama just a few days before, talking to sharecroppers in Alabama. He had moved across the country talking to sharecroppers, talking to poor people, black, white, Hispanic, Native Americans, Asian, in the service of organizing a poor people's march. Sometimes we have to put all the dots together to understand where we're translating this. We know that a year before, April 4th, 1967, he gave the speech that most people feel was his death sentence beyond Vietnam. There he took his triplets of racism, militarism, and materialism, and said, "This is robbing the moral spirit of this country. This capitalism, this system that had come into existence at the beginning of the 19th century, one based on plantation capitalism. That's what it is. We know that. Within 40 years, within the first 40 years." Of this country's existence. It became the most wealthiest country in the world from 1800 to 1840, the most wealthiest country in the world. Built on the blacks of slaves, built on their backs, created on their backs. So we look at this, all this an amazing information, and we look at ourselves right here in the age of, I don't say return of racism, but the blatant existence of it, the realization that it never did go away.
That's right.
The realization that we still had battles to fight. The realization that we have to determine where we stand on the issues of justice, where we stand on the issues that affect all of us, humanity itself, right here. We sit in here looking at not only black people, but humanity itself. And while King talked about that, he knew that his purpose and his mission and his was to save the soul of this country. I think about this moment in terms of the work that's here, the work that's being done, the intricate work. I'm one of those, how would you say, one of those young people who came to the Model Cities program in the Office of Community Development in 1971. With all of its great ideas, all the ideas of transforming, of empowering people, empowering communities, and transforming those communities in that. I came to that moment in San Francisco, California. Little did I know that there was another plan in place. And whether that plan had the had the approval, stamp of approval by black politicians or not, it was in place. It was called gentrification. Yeah. It had been called redevelopment when I was in at the Western Addition Community Organization in 1966 as a 20-year-old young man just attending to find out what was happening to a traditionally black neighborhood, the Fillmore. The Fillmore that I lived in, the Fillmore that I grew up in, I just saw that change overnight. People were disempowered to the point now that the population of black San Francisco, you can take the whole population of every black person in San Francisco, put them in Pacquiao Park, which sees 43,000 people, and you won't fill a park up. That's what has happened. They've been moved to the outskirts. So taking all this into consideration, taking all this into consideration, the role that we play as citizens, the role that we play as elected officials, the role that we play in community building, building businesses is essential. Community businesses in the past wasn't Starbucks. Community business was businesses that were connected to what was happening in the community. If there was a strike in the community, they were involved in the strike. If there was some uprising in the community, they were involved. If they were absent, they were absent from what was happening in those communities. So if we talk about this moment, in this realizing this moment, in this moment where we saw enormous, we saw the Great Recession and the impact it had, not only on black people, but specifically black women. Black women were the hardest hit by the housing fallout. Anyway, we have to realize all these things as we move into developing our narrative. What is our narrative? What is the narrative that we're going to talk about? It's going to include the work that you're doing right here, but there's going to be an assemblage of other ideas as well that would nurture us and nurture us in a different way. We don't know what those ideas are. We don't have any idea because imagination is extraordinary. Yeah. Our imagination and our ability to transform, to make those things happen as individuals, collectively, as citizens, that's what we're talking about. So we're talking about a number of things here. We know what the Marshall Plan was.
Yeah.
We know about the Marshall Plan, how it rebuilt Europe. The United States was the only economy left intact after World War II. So what it did was it created for the United States and U.S. plantation capitalism. This is what it created. It created the golden years of U.S. capitalism from 1945 to 1975. That's what the Marshall Plan was built on that. Not only rebuilding Europe, you are also rebuilding Japan as well and the rest of the world. So established a new set of wealth in this country. By the end of World War II, 75% of the wealth was owned by the United States. Right now, over 75% of the wealth is owned by corporations. Uh-huh. That's the reality, yes, in that sense. Yes. It determines whether it wants to destabilize a small government or it determines whether it wants to destabilize a city. It does all of that. And when we think about those ideas, take in consideration the march that we have, the journey that we've been on. Like I said, I came with the Model Cities program. What did the Model Cities program do? It provided all of us who were graduating from college, who were the baby boomers, an opportunity, a job. Not unlike in 1948 when my mother and father came to the post office. How many people in here, parents, cousins, daddy, mommy, everybody worked at the post office? Almost everybody around the country. We had somebody who was connected to the post office. It provided this bridge for those who were assimilating, who had been victimized, and also who had been disenfranchised, an opportunity to get into the idea of the quote-unquote American dream or whatever. So those things happened. So it did that. It provided that space. King understood clearly in his speech on April 4th, 1967, he said clearly, when he talked about the war in Vietnam, how he was eviscerating, and he used eviscerating the anti-poverty program, the war on poverty, as he says. Those monies didn't go for that. They were going for killing Vietnamese. That money should be designated for what we needed to do, what needed to happen, what really needed to happen in this country in terms of doing justice and doing right by African Americans, was now finding itself wasted upon war. We see the same thing happening today. In fact, he had gone to the office, the budget of office affairs, and came up with a number in terms of how much it would take to do justice to African Americans, former slaves, in that plantation capitalism itself. So we understand that it could be done. We saw it done in Europe. We saw what happened in Europe, where it raised the levels of health care, the Marshall Plan. It rebuilt the whole structure. In fact, you almost want to think that they bombed and devastated everything in order to so they could rebuild it and use that as a platform toward increasing their power and increasing their wealth. So we what is that narrative that we need to talk about? How does that narrative involve committed elected officials? These men and women here, the mayor here, committed for real change. How do we find, not only that, how do we find our international bridge with other countries and other communities as well? How do we build those relationships with what's happening? You look at Brazil, you have the landless movement, MST. The landless movement in Brazil has placed significantly over 450,000 families on abandoned land. That's over 1.45 million people that they placed on record. How do we connect with them? Because it's a narrative there. It's a narrative for transformation as well. So as we talk about this, what is the narrative for transformation? You know, I was in Venezuela. As Venezuela was last week commemorating the 164th year since the abolition of slavery. When you count that had to be in 1854. When did the U.S. abolish slavery? 1863, January 1st, 1863. That's when they abolished, at least the decree came out there, but we know what happened after that, and subsequently what happened with that. So on the one hand, I was in a community called Barlovento, primarily African descended communities. It grew its own cocoa. It took that cocoa and made chocolate with it, and it built a viable community there, with relationships that went beyond just the making of chocolate itself. With relationships that were much larger than that. They had begun the process of transformation. King always talked about what is the road to transformation? Right. What is the pathway to transformation? Not simply that we have a job, not simply that we have been successful in what we do in terms of our business, but what is that transformation? What is that process for transformation? We need more and more to talk about that, to add that as leverage in what we do as work. For the work that we do now, in the legacy of King, of all those fallen, all those who have left us, all those who have given so much of their own time, sacrifice, and everything else, what does that transformation look like? And how do we create a world that works, a city that works for all of us, not only a city that works for all of us, but a state that works for all of us, and et cetera, et cetera. That is our task. We have to find that narrative. And it's a dynamic narrative. The contradictions have changed, whether they are. Even though we see the manifestation of Trump and we pay a lot of attention to what he's tweaking and everything else, the real transformation went long before Trump came into power. What was happening, what were the changes that were happening? The reinstitution of racism, the breakdown of the society itself, the breakdown of all those things that the New Deal brought. The New Deal brought all these particular things, put them into place, and every moment since then, it's been an attempt to undermine it. The Voting Rights Act, all those things that dissuade us to be real citizens and active citizens in our own rescue. Active citizens in our own rescue. So that narrative has to complete that. Include that as well. So these are moments that we have to take serious, to think out Find ways to collaborate with all aspects of hear, listen, grow, and build. Thank you so much.